Good afternoon. Let me introduce our today's expert from Hungary, from the Budapest Institute for Policy Analysis, Dr. Balázs Váradi, who is also a professor at Eötvös Loránd University, specializing in public policy. And one of the Budapest Institute's fields is healthcare. So today we invited Dr. Váradi for a presentation about healthcare reform efforts in Hungary and possible lessons for us. And now I would like to invite our speaker to start the presentation.
Okay, thank you very much for having me. Can you hear me and see my first slide?
Yeah,
okay.
Yes, it's fine. Yeah.
Good, okay. So it's a pleasure. It's always a pleasure. It would have been even nicer to visit your region. I'm happy when I can go to Armenia or Georgia, wonderful countries. And this is second best. So I will make this quick because we don't have a lot of time. Why Hungary, right? So why would you be interested in an episode of Hungarian healthcare reform with rather mixed success, right? Well, I would argue that small countries are in many ways similar. I would argue, this is an even better argument, that we inherited a similar healthcare provision system from Soviet times, right? Hungary had a slightly different background before 1948 or 49, but then a pretty similar centralized healthcare system was introduced that actually achieved a lot in terms of public health during the years of socialism. So we have similar institutional background. And you will see that the Hungarian reforms that I will describe happened at the time of political upheaval, which is an additional challenge or an opportunity. So I thought these were reasons why you might be interested in what I will say. Why me, right? Armen kindly introduced me as an expert and an academic, and I am indeed an independent expert at the Budapest Institute and a teacher at Alte University. But at the time of the reform that I will speak about, I actually worked for the government. I was an advisor to the prime minister. And although originally I was planned to work on fields like economic policy and education policy, given that the major policy initiative under that government ended up being a wide-ranging healthcare reform, I ended up working on this day and night for many months. So my vantage point was special. In many ways, I saw the inner workings of the reform. This also means that I'm not as unbiased as an outside expert would be. Of course, I have strong views. I try not to push those on you and give you a description of what happened and some lessons, but I mean, that's a mission impossible. Clearly, if you are in the eye of the storm, then you will have strong views, right? So this is a disclaimer as well. So when describing the healthcare reforms in Hungary that were introduced in 2006 through 2008, first it is in order to describe the health situation of Hungary at the time. So I have a few slides here that come from OECD health at a glance graphs and tables that show you what Hungary's healthcare situation looked like at the time when the reforms were first considered and how Hungary looked at itself in comparison to its competitors or its peers, right? Often Hungary, at that point, Hungary was already in the EU, right? And the standard comparison was and is with the other three Visegrad countries, the Czech Republic, Slovakia, and Poland, but also other middle-income countries to the southeast of Hungary, like Romania and Bulgaria, and farther afield, like Turkey. So these are life expectancy values at the age of 40. And you can see that Hungary is the solid line. And you can see that There was a drop after the system change in the early 90s. This happened even more more so in post-Soviet countries and Russia. And then there was an improvement, but it was a very limited improvement, and Hungary had much lower life expectancies than any of those comparative countries, both for men and for women, right? So it looked like this is not, there is a problem here. And of course, life expectancy is not just about healthcare, it's about lifestyle and other things, but it is about healthcare as well. Now, there was another issue, which was the expenditure on pharmaceutical, on drugs. Apparently in the 2005, Hungary was one of the OECD countries, if not the OECD country, that spent the biggest proportion of its GDP on pharmaceuticals. This adds private expenditure as well as public expenditure, and of course, in proportion of GDP, right? So clearly, if you did a purchasing power parity comparison, the values will have been higher in more richer countries. But this still suggests that somehow things were not as efficient as they should be. Another graph shows that while this was a relatively good decade for Hungary in terms of economic growth, right? So the average growth rate in GDP was between 4 and 5% between 95 and 2005. The costs were going up just as much, right? So this was not, here Hungary is not an outlier, right? But apparently the health costs were growing faster than the economy, though not much faster. Now, apparently, this is doctor's consultation per capita in 2005, and it turns out that Hungarian doctors had to see the most patients after the Czech Republic and Japan in the OECD, right? So apparently doctors were overworked, or there were not enough doctors, or the way they spent their time was not efficient. Anyway, something was wrong there. And they were underpaid. So this is doctors' remuneration as a ratio to GDP per capita. And you can see both for specialists, that's the left-hand side, and the general practitioners, that Hungary had a relatively low value compared to many other countries. Again, not a huge outlier here, but markedly lower than many other countries, right? So the doctors were not very well paid. I put officially in parentheses because there is a widespread culture in Hungary of informal payments by private by patients to doctors in different settings, especially in hospital settings. This is known in several countries, but estimates suggest that in Hungary it was especially prevalent, rather high. Then another issue that came up was that Hungary had a lot of hospital capacity, probably more than necessary. You can see that these are acute care hospital beds per 1,000 people in the country for 1990 and 2005. And you can see that Hungary, even though this came down a bit, was still way above OECD levels. Again, not a huge outlier. And you can see that Germany had even more hospital beds, right? And Japan, with its aging population, was especially high up. But on the whole, Hungary was on the more capacity side in terms of hospitals. And this was probably linked to the fact that the average length of stay for normal say delivery, right, was long in Hungary. So these hospitals had to be filled with people. So people were kept in hospital, probably again longer than was necessary, right? So this is for deliveries, just as an example. But Hungary had the longest spell for mothers to stay in hospital after delivery. These were just some of the signals that the system probably was ripe for reform. There were others that are harder to present with neat graphs, One was glaring differences in quality and access to care, both geographically. So there were poorer parts of Hungary, it's a relatively small country, but there are differences in terms of per capita income and schooling and whatever between the Northeast and Southwest, which are poorer, and between the center and the West, which are richer. And indeed, there are differences between both the quality of care and access to care in terms of the time it takes to get to a hospital between these areas. And also there are big differences in the use of healthcare across different income groups. So the poor use less of the hospitals and outpatient care. And this is something I already mentioned. There was a demeaning, unfair, and untaxed informal payment system by patients to doctors that was reviled but accepted by everyone, especially doctors who were underpaid. So this was a way for them to make up for the difference between what they expected to make and what they were paid. And there was a general interpretation that this is intimately linked with the fact that this was not a patient-friendly or a client-friendly system, and on scoring how patients felt in hospitals and what they thought about the experience, it turns out that patients felt bad and felt at the mercy of the institutions, and they felt they were not served but considered to be serfs and lorded over by hospital administration and nurses and doctors. So this was quite a bunch of problems, but the one slide that just shows you that things were not going right is going back to life expectancy again. So this is a comparison again from 2005 of different countries. Alas, Armenia is not here because these are OECD countries, I think. And this is health spending per capita, how much the individual countries spend on healthcare. And this is the life expectancy, right? And this is a regression curve. And the way to read this is that more money buys you longer life. And there is a relationship between that, not linear, but increasing. And countries that are above the regression line have a longer life than the spending in their country explains, and countries below the line people are living shorter than you would expect given the spending on healthcare, right? So you can see that there are three countries that are way below the line, right? Turkey in the poorer group, United States, where the expected life expectancy is relatively high, but they spend an enormous amount on their healthcare system, right? So you might argue that it's probably inefficient. And Hungary, right? So Hungary is, again, way below the line, whereas, say, Poland is on it, right? So this, I think, encapsulates the claim that there is a lot of room for improvement in healthcare in Hungary. And this was generally accepted in Hungary in 2005-2006. There were, however, several competing explanations about what is the problem or what are the problems behind these bad indices. So there was the general claim that just the whole thing is badly governed in terms of health policy, in terms of hospital management, in terms of every element of the system. Another claim was that the state was not very good in its purchasing role, especially as far as pharmaceuticals are concerned, right? It's just that we are wasteful in terms of paying more for drugs than we should and other inputs that the government buys from private actors. Often the claim was made that this was due to rent seeking or corruption or political economy factors like that. There was a claim that there is a lack of information about quality, about waiting times, about what different hospitals can provide, about where, what your rights are, about what is financed by your government healthcare system, and what is it that you cannot expect it to do. So this was something that that often was mentioned as a reason for the bad setup. There was a claim that somehow, and I will come back to this because this is a major issue, there was a claim that the problem was that this was all or almost all a state system, that neither the providers nor the insurers, with some exceptions, were private actors, right? So the claim was that if more role was given to private agents, NGOs, nonprofits, but especially for-profit hospitals, providers, general practitioners, drug companies, and insurers, then that would open up a big source of efficiency, right? This was, you shouldn't forget that this was the neoliberal time. So in the 90s and even in the early 2000s, in ex-communist countries, a widespread perception of public policy problems was that socialism was bad, and whatever we inherited for socialism, but whatever still works in statist way is bad, whereas the marketplace can bring competition and efficiency. Marketplace populated with private actors, right? So this is another interpretation. And the last suggestion as to what was wrong in Hungary was that patient pathways, where patients go when they are ill, are not well regulated, that the general practitioners don't act as a gatekeeper, that many people end up in inpatient care when they should be taken care of in outpatient care, that there is an overly, the consumption of pharmaceuticals goes beyond what's necessary, that people ask for second and third opinions, that that the it's not managed well the way the patients are tracing out trajectories in the healthcare system. Okay, these are not exclusive, and several of them could be true, right? So this was the state of the debate in 2006, when there opened up a big political economy window of opportunity for reform. The previous socialist liberal coalition, the Socialist Party and the Free Democrats, succeeded in being re-elected in 2006, which was a first since 1990 in Hungary. Before that, there was always a big change in who governs in every 4 years. And that happened on the back of a very irresponsible spending expenditure spree in 2004, 5, and early 2006. So when the old coalition got the mandate to govern Hungary again, it was clear that there was a big challenge to institute budget savings, fiscal consolidation, because if they didn't, Hungary would go bankrupt within a year or two. I mean, at some point in the summer of 2006, after the elections, the projected deficit of the central budget was expected to be 11% of GDP for that year alone, right? So I think it's really falling apart. It was clear that you have to do something on the expenditure side. This was one thing. And the other thing was that with the support of the prime minister, the liberals, the smaller, the junior party in coalition, decided that for the next 4 years, their big thing will be healthcare, right? I mean, they could not expect to have a big influence on the government. They were a minor party in terms of number of votes in parliament. And they could not expect to produce tax breaks, because in order for the country not to go bankrupt, taxes had to be raised, not lowered, right? So they needed to produce something in terms of policy results. And with the tacit support of the prime minister, the would-be prime minister, Ferenc Gyurcsány, they claimed the portfolio of the healthcare, of the healthcare minister, and the person, an ex-hospital director who was known to be somebody who is ready to take conflicts, even revels in conflicts, and who was a visionary and who had strong views and strong opinions, was nominated for healthcare minister. Lajos Molnár was his name, and in a strange way, he was a chain smoker, right? Which is not something you would expect from a health minister, but you know, there was a lot of stress. So there was a decision to reform healthcare, right? That this was the big, would be the big thing in this cycle, this political cycle. And this was expected to produce budget savings. And it was, the diagnosis accepted basically was that the main problem, yes, those other things, pathways and corruption, whatever, are also in place. But the main problem is that the healthcare sector still is run by the state, right? That it's a vestige of socialism. And the solution, therefore, will be to introduce competition there. So the main thrust of healthcare reform was decided on political and ideological reasons to introduce private participation in healthcare, especially in the health insurance part, right? So that it wouldn't just be the state that insures everyone or most people who work, but that there should be competing private health insurers out there. So this was an ideological, to a large extent, an idea, plausible, but not universally accepted diagnosis, right? And a rather ideological way take on what's wrong and what should be done. Now, the people who did not share this diagnosis and this prescription were many of the socialist members of parliament, right? Who were the majority party, and even though their prime minister enthusiastically accepted this approach, many of the socialist politicians in the second and third rank were more statist. Well, of course, the Socialist Party was the direct descendant of the state Socialist Party in a reform, a longer reform line from before the change of system. So they liked, in many ways, the statist system. So this was the setup. Now, what were the main elements of the reform? Time is flying, right? So I list the main elements of the reform. I claim there were many, and this was the big thing, and there were special government cabinet meetings just for healthcare. So in addition to health cabinet meetings every week, there was a healthcare cabinet meeting for many, many months where the only thing discussed was healthcare reform. So this was really the major issue of the time. But I'll pick out the five most important elements of that healthcare reform. So there was a reform of the pharmaceutical market and the way government participated in financing drugs and the system of transparent price competition was basically introduced, mostly based on the British system, how the NHS finances the cheapest among a group of drugs that have the similar effects, and how the producers are expected to bid, and how generics are expected to compete, and the price should be set if there are generic drugs to that level. So this was a major change in how the government decided to pay for most of the costs of drugs. The second was a reduction in inpatient capacity, right, in hospitals. So basically closing down hospitals, right? And aside that the hospital, it's not just the number of beds or capacity in general, the structure was also wasteful. There were many small hospitals in Hungary that were way below efficient scale. And there are several reasons for that. One reason is historic, actually, because in the Soviet system, there were explicit plans for the Third World War and the Soviet army and the Hungarian army attacking the West by way of Hungary and by way of Austria. So they needed hospitals close to the front, the future front. So there were many, many small hospitals on the west of Hungary So there it was capacity, but also the structure of what hospitals there were. And there was the decision that many of these should be closed down. There was an idea of strengthening the referral system and making explicit, transparent systems of waiting lists about what procedure, what time, when you can be expected to be operated on if it was not urgent or seen by the doctor. There was a considerable increase in co-payments for pharmaceuticals, but also outpatient care and inpatient care. The idea that the patient has to pay not a huge sum, but a couple of hundred forints, so it's like, you know, 1 or 2 euros for every day they spend in hospital and for every box of pills and every visit with the outpatient department to bring down unnecessary interaction, probably, and also remind everyone that this is not free. And then, and this was the major thing, there was a decision to change the single purchasing agency and introduce a still universal, but private and competing health insurance system where a few big health insurance companies you could pick. They were expected to take you, so they didn't have a choice to not accept you because of old conditions. And the expectation was that they would pay for your health insurance when you have to go to the hospital, and that private insurers would enter this market, and that would make things much more efficient. So this is quite a package, right? And it was relatively quickly instituted, a couple of months, and they started to introduce this. Now, the last but one thing is I tell you how these reforms fared, right? So before I go there, this could at this point still end in two ways, right? It could be a description of a quick and aggressive, but ultimately hugely successful reform that we are proud of, or it could end up being an utter failure, right? That I used to just tell you that, like a pathologist, right? Showing you, you know, the terrible disease and then teaching you how to not deal with the problem because then you will fail like we did, right? So far, you can guess, right? At this point, it's up to you. Make your bets, right? How did it fare? What did come out of it? How did these individual bits of reform introduced in parallel actually fare? What's your guess? Which bit worked, which bit didn't, right? So just give it some thought, right? I mean, many of you are professionals who can imagine, you know, trying to change things in the healthcare field, and these are big changes, clearly. Okay, so jokes aside, let me tell you how this worked out, and then I draw some conclusions, and then we are done because I don't have a lot of time. So, introducing transparent bidding and financing the cheapest within drug groups, and thereby bringing down the cost of state financing pharmaceuticals. Well, there was quite some resistance by the drug companies, clearly, but on the whole, it worked out. Hungary introduced a system similar to the British system, and many tens of billions of forints were saved year over year, while the amount of drugs that people were prescribed and bought did not go down. So it's actually basically, this was a success in curbing the profits of the drug sellers and saving some money in the budget by a better, more transparent and system of buying drugs, purchasing drugs, and better incentives, right? So this is, I start with a happy thing. I could have ordered them in a different way and then it couldn't have started so happily, right? Now, the next thing was restructuring hospitals. Now here the idea was that not for the government to directly say which hospitals should be closed down, but basically suggesting to the local hospital managers and politicians to come up with their suggestion about which of the five small town hospitals should be closed down in their region, right? This sounds good, clever politically, but it didn't work out because the local hospital managers and politicians just said, no, we are not going to amputate our own limbs, right? We are not, this is not something we are ready to decide. If you want to kill some of us, you come with your guns and you kill us. So basically this didn't work out. The local elites just did not participate in this. So ultimately there were some lists and suggestions, and then was the worst kind of political melee that you can imagine, long weekend meetings with frenzied politicians and members of parliament and mayors lobbying like crazy for their hospitals, and ultimately a very limited version of hospitals being closed down took place, and not necessarily the most inefficient hospitals were closed down. If you were a strong member of parliament and you were a strong mayor, if the local MP was a minister, then your hospital was saved, even if it was a small and inefficient hospital. And you can understand this. I mean, it's for a small town, the hospital to be closed down, that's a terrible thing. It's like closing down the high school, right? It's like taking away the soccer team, right? It's in many ways a very bad thing. So anywhere politics is like that, right? But there was the government needed the support of these politicians to vote from week to week in parliament for other not very popular budgetary measures, right? So they were not in a very good position. So some savings were achieved, but the uproar and the conflict and the capacity, political time wasted, was way bigger than what was achieved in terms of bringing down the number of acute beds. And most of the hospitals were then used for something else, right? Relabeled. Not closed down. Okay. Now, as for transparent waiting lists, there was some improvement there, but of course, this was not compatible with the informal payment system where you could, you know, give some tip to your doctor and hope to be operated on quick, right? So this was contrary to how financing was taking place for doctors. So some of it was built up, but a lot of it was sabotaged, right? This cannot be done, that is not comparable. And ultimately when this period was over, it was turned around to a large extent, and there is relatively little that remains of transparent waiting lists in hospitals. There is some improvement there. Now, co-payments were the lightning rod. So that was if you ask a layperson about what he or she remembers of the 2006-2007 health reforms in Hungary, this is what people will remember, right? That I pay my taxes for state-provided shitty healthcare, and then I have to pay another 354 inch for just seeing the doctor, right? That this is crazy, this is unacceptable. Now, this was not popular, in other words. But that's not the primary problem. It wasn't popular with the patients, right? But it wasn't popular by the doctors and the hospital managers either, who basically sabotaged this as well. I mean, some of it was introduced again, but since it had to be receipts and who you pay and where you pay, I mean, it would have been the hospital managers and the doctors themselves who had to organize this. They organized it in a half-hearted manner, and they explain to the individual patients that they are just as much against it as they are, because this is crazy, this doesn't make sense. So while the economic, the budgetary effect of this was very limited, right, because the co-payment was small, it was the channel through which the unhappiness with the whole reform actually went. So it was the battle cry of the opponents of the system. Now this takes us to another thing, that while this was a healthcare reform in principle in service of better healthcare or more efficient healthcare, given the fact that there was also a budgetary crunch, the way it was perceived, and rightfully so, was that this was basically a bunch of cutbacks, right? The government messed up, having messed up their budget policy in the previous 2 years in order to win again, now they are saving on our healthcare, right? And that's, they are selling this to us as reforms, right? Reforms, my foot. They are just asking for extra money, right? And closing down hospitals. So this was a combination of increasing efficiency, but also taking out some of the resources in order to avoid bankruptcy, right? And this is not a politically very, very popular proposition, I suggest. Okay. And then comes health insurance reform, right? Yeah, the big thing, the main idea that you want to have private participants and competition, and that will bring efficiency and patient-centered, consumer-oriented or patient-oriented approach and more efficiency. Now, there were voices as early as the very beginning of this, so 2006, that suggested that this is not a good diagnosis, right? It's not competition. Healthcare is a very special field with a lot of asymmetric information and a lot of challenges, and you cannot expect the private ownership and competition to just solve the problem, right? And actually, there were experts invited from the West, right? From the United States, from the Netherlands, from countries that run systems like what the Hungarian system was planned to be. And many of those experts said, don't do what we have done, right? This doesn't work. We have problems with moral hazard. We have problems with adverse selection. We have a lot of problems in this field. Competition is not necessarily the best solution. Some of the most efficient countries are operating state-run healthcare systems, like the United Kingdom, right? They are not happy with it. No country is happy with its own healthcare system, right? Some systems are composite systems, right? Some systems are good, but very expensive, so not necessarily efficient, right? So the external advice was not necessarily in line with this privatization approach. And also, there was no support for this within the governing coalition, right? I mean, this required laws to pass in the legislature, so you had to have the socialists and the liberals on board. And whereas the liberals were very happy with this, right? They actually pushed for this. The socialists were not happy. And this produced a number of incredibly half-hearted compromises between the socialists and the liberals in terms of what this health insurance system, privatized health insurance systems would work. And ultimately, a compromise was produced that was not making happy anyone, right? And this was at the time when the public was already very happy, very unhappy with the copayment and other elements and the hospitals being closed down. And parallelly with this, the opposition succeeded in collecting enough support to organize a referendum against every significant element of this healthcare reform. And as the referendum was being planned, the potential participants in this private healthcare insurance system, which is something that the Slovaks actually introduced somewhat earlier, so it's not unheard of. And again, similar to what the Netherlands operates and some other countries, the insurers basically changed their minds in terms of whether they wanted to enter this market at all, right? And this is a long-term thing, and there was a referendum organized against it. It was organized by the opposition party, so even if the referendum did not decide against it, those people will be in power next time, and those will go back, right? And go back to state-provided healthcare, right? This is, I mean, it was a right-wing party, but in this sense, they were statist, and they said, we support the status quo ante, and we don't want this. So ultimately, there was a referendum that the government lost, and the insurance companies said they would not want to enter this field, so they had, the government had to basically turn back on this and say we are not doing this. But by that time, the coalition was falling apart and the support of the prime minister was not there, and ultimately he had to resign before the next election, and the technical term, the caretaker prime minister, hobbled along until the next elections, where the opposition party Fidesz won with a resounding two-thirds majority, which was enough for them to change the constitution, and they have been in power ever since, right? So in this sense, this fiasco is with us in its consequences to this day. Okay, so I will finish, because time is almost up, by asking what are the lessons, right? So what have we learned from this? And there are many things that you may have learned, right? I mean, this is a rich story, and I haven't told you the many anecdotal, interesting bits of it, right? So I could have spoken hours and hours about this. It was a wild, wild time, and a lot of interesting, larger than life people and bad decisions and stress and excitement. But I think that there are three lessons that are reasonably robust and not just my ideas. One is that in a field as complex as healthcare, this is true for education policy and a number of other fields as well, but especially healthcare, generally ideological intuition may lead you astray, right? So you have to actually learn the details of the field and the mechanisms and what works and what doesn't from theory, but especially from other countries, right? And you have to bracket your ideological preferences to a large extent. I mean, they are still there. Some people like the market, other people trust the state, but you can make huge mistakes if you think that's enough guidance for policy solutions. Right? Learn from others. The second lesson, that it's a more optimistic one, that even, I mean, this huge mess, the way pharmaceuticals are financed by the government was reformed in a good way, and it still, to a large extent, works on the same pattern still, although Fidesz came into power in 2010. So there are sometimes boxed solutions that you can learn from and implement in your own country. You have to be very careful because the context is different and everything is different. But there are copy-paste elements of reforms, and there is no. You have to be very mindful of, you know, what can go wrong. But sometimes you can just copy good solutions, and they will work for you as well. So there was an element. And the third one is the hardest if you are in the business of changing the world by being a secretary of state and an expert and an advisor and whatever, that this area has a lot of stakeholders and change is incredibly costly in every dimension, right? In terms of human costs, right? I mean, if the hospitals are closed down, then the ambulance has to take people to another place, and if you have to work for another hospital, then you will have to move as a doctor, and if you have to switch drugs, and so there is a huge adjustment cost, and also emotional things, and this is about life and death, right? Not just about, you know, your favorite brand not being sold in the supermarket anymore. So rushing it, changing healthcare systems fast, can have enormous political and social costs, right? So probably if you want to reform healthcare, you have to identify partial things to do and not try to change everything, and give warning and arrive at compromises and listen to the stakeholders and budget some money, not trying to wring out all the extra efficiency that you achieve by spending less, but actually spending as much as earlier, just spending it more efficiently, and achieve sustainable coalitions that will make sure that the changes stay in place even after the government is gone. This is less fishy than, you know, trying to change everything on a dime, but this is probably the wise way to try and reform healthcare. And I stop here. And if I have any more time, then I'm happy to answer some questions.
Thank you very much, Balazs. We have two distinguished Armenian healthcare experts here, but before giving the opportunity for them to comment or ask questions, I would just make several remarks from my own experience, maybe, because I remember those opposition demonstrations 2006-07, including against the, some aspects of the healthcare reform. And you mentioned the cancellations per capita among the highest in OECD in Hungary.
Mm-hmm.
And Slovakia was just a little below, but I guess they reduced that number by introducing this co-payment because the patients have to pay €2 in Slovakia, which is not refunded, just to see a doctor and then doctor sends to another one, to specialist, that is totally covered, mm-hmm. Drugs as well, but treatments, but not that initial payment of €2. So do Hungary still have this problem that elderly people, some lonely people who just go to the doctor and
spend
additional time?
This is, some research has been done on this, and I think that to a large extent, this is anecdotal. So it's, yes, it does occur that elderly people, often ladies, right, because they live longer, just go to see the doctor because they need social interaction, right? And this is the one way to do that. But, I mean, this can happen. But there are other issues, like there was a change in terms of how many months the doctor can prescribe your drugs, right, for. And, you know, and making this a longer period when medically this is acceptable might help the number of, bring down the number of interactions. There is, improving the timing and how you can sign up and how you can, find the right time slot. So there are things that you can do. But Slovakia is an important thing, and I did mention it at some point, but I want to stress that not that long time before this happened, Slovakia actually successfully introduced a similar reform, right? Then a lot of it was turned back, not all of it, but some of it was turned up, but it was a very important reference. And it was also a matter of hurt pride that Hungary has to learn from Slovakia, right? Hungary looks down on all the neighboring countries, basically, except for Austria, certainly on Slovakia, Romania, and Serbia, right? They for historical and cultural reasons, right? And to have to learn from Slovakia, that was hard to sell, right? And for cultural reasons, right? Hungarians consider themselves to be the top dogs in the Carpathian Basin, okay?
Concerning the life expectancy and the lifestyle, that relation, I remember that smoking among women was one of the highest rates in the world in Hungary at some point.
Yeah, it has gone down, and actually the Fidesz government instituted a very ambitious program of increasing the price of tobacco and outlawing smoking in different settings. And they have succeeded in bringing that down. But you're right, and then they mentioned this, that it's slightly misleading to look at life expectancy and ascribe that to the healthcare system, because to a large extent, it's about lifestyle. So it's about smoking, yes, rather high in Hungary. It's also obesity, which is also widespread. It's also about not eating enough vitamins. It's about very limited sports. So there are, a heavy cuisine full of lard and stuff. So there is a lot of lifestyle elements, and there is an argument has been made that it's more efficient to try and increase life expectancy by trying to influence lifestyle than to spend on curative care, right? So it's easier to keep people healthy than to cure them when they are already sick. And it's cheaper to do that as well. This is an issue everywhere, but it has especially been an issue in Hungary. Some EU resources have now been spent on these lifestyle elements. And again, there was a crusade against smoking. So there is some improvement there. But yes, you are right. I mean, the difference that I've shown, a big chunk of that is about lifestyle, not healthcare quality.
I have a couple of questions about the current situation, because these informal payments or bribes, this has been issued out. There have been several trials in the recent months, I guess. The doctors put on trial for that.
And there is a big change there, but it's way too early to judge how successful that is. After the first wave of the pandemic, there was a take it or leave it offer by the government to doctors, basically increasing their salaries by quite a big amount, but in return accepting a much more onerous labor contract and outlawing informal payments completely. And there was some haggling, but on the whole, the doctors accepted this. So in principle, now the government can go after doctors who accept informal payments and send them to prison. Now, this is easy to say, but if it remains a widespread practice, then the government will not spend 50% of the Hungarian doctors into prison, right? So it's everyone. Now, under COVID, the situation is quite different. A lot of elective procedures have been postponed. So we don't know yet whether this draconian approach succeeded or not, right? Or will succeed or not. And I really don't know. I wonder. In a year or two, we'll see.
What's the issue of people currently losing their insurance? Some 70,000 people, I read, could not pay that monthly amount. So it's about 8,000 forints, I guess. For our audience here, it's people who don't work and pay taxes have to pay in Armenian dirhams. It's about 14,500 a month. So they get this state. Some 70,000 people are currently not insured in Hungary.
Yeah. So this is, again, in principle, while health insurance was and to a large extent is practically universal, right? Formally, it was always an insurance-based system. So you were expected to, or rather your employer was expected to pay for your state insurance. Of course, university students were insured and prisoners were insured, whatever. But otherwise, if you were a grown up, not in dire straits, you were expected to be paid for. And there was a concern that there are many people who are free riding on this fact, and they just don't either. They take black employment, right, in the black market, and their employer doesn't pay for them, and they don't bother to pay for themselves. This is the amount you mentioned, you could. Or people who usually work abroad, but then come home every now and then for a couple of months. Many people work in Germany, or used to rather. And then they don't bother again to make sure that they are covered, and that this is free riding. And the government thought that this is the Fidesz government, so it's a relatively recent measure. They thought that the way to enforce this and get rid of this free riding is that you actually, the people who are not covered, will have to pay for their healthcare. And this was introduced, but with a time lag, and the time lag expires right now. So in principle, there are again tens of thousands of people who are not covered and who, when they go to the hospital, will face up to a hefty bill. We are not sure how this will play out, because there are many people who are not insured because of administrative mess up, right? So there are probably thousands upon thousands of people where the employer just used the wrong number and the administration doesn't know what's going on. And so there are a lot of people who will show up as uninsured, but they are insured. It's just that it's not managed well. Then there will be people who are not insured, but not giving them health services or giving them a bill that makes them bankrupt will look like an oversized punishment for something like that. We'll see how lenient de facto the hospitals will be, right? I mean, a lot of these things are decided not in the on the pages of the code of the laws, but in real practice, right? How this is handled. Again, we are looking forward to learning about how this changes behavior. Probably, I mean, I wouldn't think that people, you know, showing up in the hospital with COVID-19 will be charged tens of thousands of forints because they are not covered. So I expect some stopgap sort of arrangement to show up at least for the period of the pandemic. But ultimately, we'll see. We'll see. If this turns out to be a relatively painless way to make free riders pay up, then it's good. If it's a way to cause tens of thousands of Hungarians to not get treatment who should, right? Then, or send them into even deeper social holes, then this is going to be a disaster. We'll see. I'm strongly against this measure, but let's give it some time to learn.
Thank you very much. And we may need to finish some 15 minutes earlier than previously. Mm-hmm. So in about 45 minutes, so I suppose it's enough time now, and let's use it for questions. So I would like to ask our experts to jump in and make some comments or ask for clarifications, maybe. So I'll turn the laptop so you may see each other as well.
My name is Samvel Kharazyan. I'm a health financing expert. And thank you. First, for very good presentation, it is very useful and very interesting. And now Armenia has developed the next step of healthcare reform, and the government developed a concept note for universal health insurance implementation. In 2019, we have a large discussion with the public in the parliament, in the government, about these conceptual principles of the implementation of insurance system. And your presentation and your experience is very useful for us. related with this, I want to ask you some questions about the overall reform in Hungary, and more specific in implementation of social health insurance scheme. The first question is, you mentioned about political and government attitude of this situation, and of course how the healthcare system and sectors against to the reforms. When you talked about it, I remember the situation in Armenia, when the first step of the reform was started in early 1995-96. For this, every time when we're talking about the implementation of the health insurance system, or we want to make systematically changes, the society and the government asked from Ministry of Health, and do you think that we have this good socioeconomic situation for it. For example, we have a large scale of the unemployment, we have the limitation of the budget, and we have many social problems, and it is deep with the current situation when we have the war with the Azerbaijan, and we have also the coronavirus. It is not specific for Armenia, but it is also take some potential from us also. In this case, very interesting, when Hungary started implementation of social health insurance, which kind of socioeconomic situation they have, and these indicators, unemployment rate and this lack of things, is my first question. Thank you.
Yeah, there is a general challenge to reforms in fields like healthcare that suggest that when something is planned to be changed, then those who expect to lose are much quicker to identify that they are going to be losers and feel much stronger about the potential change than the potential winners, right? Often the potential winners don't even know, they are future patients, say, right, who don't even identify themselves as future patients or the general public, because you are more efficient and so there is more money left on the table, stuff like that. I mean, that's very hard to sell, whereas however inefficient a system works, those who are in key positions in it, hospital managers, top doctors, whatever, will have found a place in it, right? Because they are there, they are, you know, they somehow find. So every change is perceived as a danger, right? They will change things and who knows, you know, but clearly it's gonna be some new situation. So ideally, to counteract this, you will want to put extra money into the change, in addition to information and, you know, and stakeholder discussions and the good designs and all of those things. You want to put extra money to balance these things out, right? To basically, to put it bluntly, to bribe at least some of the key stakeholders into supporting the change, right? I mean, the one of the things that we have learned is that maybe many of the top doctors who get a lot of these informal payments and, you know, and who are in a local position of decision making and who are the main beneficiaries of a non-transparent system, maybe we consider them the enemy, although it doesn't make sense. Individually, these are nice surgeons and, you know, and elderly doctors and whatever. But even if you think that they are there to try and stop your change, if they can stop it, right, then the only thing you can do is to try and bring them on board, right? And how can you do that? You can do that by consulting with them and discussing things in many ways and, you know, and setting out what your plans are and how they are, it's going to be good for them. But one way to do that is to sweeten the deal, right? Give them positions, make sure that the changes are gradual and they are grandfathered out, right? And their position is not dangerous until they retire or there is some extra money. I mean, it depends on the details, but you want to, I mean, one way to interpret our failure was that to make big changes and try to save money at the same time, right? That's very hard. That's very hard. What you want to do is you want to get the IMF or the World Bank or somebody come in and give you some extra money to grease the wheels of change, right? And make it an acceptable thing. And once the new system is in place and people see that it's not worse, even better in many ways, right? Then you can try and increase efficiency and take away the extra money and maybe the efficiency generates enough resources. Now, this is a very abstract argument, right? So it's not, it doesn't, it might or might not work out. Another thing that you might do, and this might work with respect to certain things, but not necessarily financing and, you know, big insurance arrangements, is piloting things. To introduce, say, a change in how the general practitioners work or how the referrals work, pick one county with one region, right? And try it out. And, you know, then it doesn't cost as much. You can put some extra resources in. The participants can consider themselves to be, you know, pioneers, and, you know, and they are not just the victims of change, right? And you can learn a lot. I mean, actually, if you can, I mean, piloting something will give you a lot of lessons about what works in your own country. The problem is that if you actually do a local pilot, that will probably eat up your political cycle, right? So if you actually introduce it, design it, do it in one county, evaluate it, then it's the next elections. And it, the big thing will have to wait, right? So it's a, the price of that is basically time. But it's a serious option that should be considered, right? I mean, again, it will not work for certain elements of healthcare reform, but it might work for others. There were quite successful changes in how the general practitioner system worked in Hungary that have been tried out that way and evaluated and then expanded. So, yeah, that's one thing. I'm not sure I was very helpful with my answer.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. The next question, which is my colleague want to ask about voluntary health insurance schemes. So when you started the reforms in healthcare system, did you have some voluntary health insurance schemes, and how they interacted with new social health insurance system? And because it is also one of the issues in Armenia now.
Absolutely, this is a very important question. We did have a relatively small voluntary health insurance sector in Hungary even before all of these changes showed up. But the problem why it couldn't grow was informal payments. I mean, it was not clear what you are entitled to, but it looked like the best way to spend your money is to go to a state hospital and be generous with the doctors, right? This bought you a better healthcare than buying some additional healthcare that, there were relatively few private providers, especially for major procedures like surgery or whatever. There was not really, I mean, the private provider could not pay the public hospital. It wasn't clear what you are entitled to anyway, right? I mean, this a complementary system works if it's clear what it is that you are entitled to in the public system, and then you can buy an insurance and that pays for the extra. It's not a four-bed, you know, ward. It's a individual ward, and it's, you don't get the heavy plaster when your hand leg is broken, but the more expensive, but, you know, lighter plaster, right? If it's clear that everyone is entitled to the heavy plaster, right, then you can pay a voluntary additional insurance for buying the lighter plaster. But if there is some heavy plaster in the system, some light plaster in the system, and nobody knows who gets what, and it probably depends on whether you go to the good hospital and pay enough in informal payments, then that's the way to go. So probably this was the reason why the complementary voluntary insurance sector was rather limited, right? And there was the issue, and there was one provider that actually suggested that you can use your insurance to make informal payments to the state doctors, basically, and the insurer will reimburse you for that, right? Which makes sense, but because this is illegal, right, you don't get a receipt. So it's relatively hard to set up an insurance where they pay for something where, you know, there is no receipt. I mean, there are all sorts of moral hazard problems there. So that was the reason why this sector was relatively limited. It served expats, it served very high income individuals, and it worked for special fields like dental work, where the rules of the game were clearer. But it wasn't widespread, so it didn't make up a sizable chunk of the whole insurance market, health insurance market.
Okay, thank you. And
sorry, this is the important thing, that I did not do justice the information problem, right? That I said that the services that the public health system provides the individual were never clearly delineated. But what's important is that who can delineate a system like that? Who can make the specialization by specialization declaration of what it is that the public healthcare system provides everyone? Well, it's going to be doctors, right? It's going to be top doctors in that field who can make that decision. And it is those top doctors, I'm simplifying now, who are the main beneficiaries of the present informal system, right? So there was a reason why this was planned for years and years and years, to give a catastrophe of, you know, what are the state healthcare provisions. And somehow those doctors never came around to make a clear determination there, right? I mean, they are, of course, by training better at individuals, handling individual cases, than making cruel but general rules about stuff, right? Because every case is different. But also it was not in their interest to clear these things up. So to this day, we don't have clear rules, entitlements about, you know, minimum level of service for the patients of the public system, which is, again, I didn't go into this, is incredibly heterogeneous. It was heterogeneous in quality, and it is heterogeneous in quality. So the state system includes some state-of-the-art, high-quality hospitals where top surgery procedures are taking place, and, you know, and people, the same surgeons do the same thing as what they do as in Germany or Austria, and incredibly run-down, low-quality places where, you know, you get infections just from the hospital, and it's a Russian roulette whether you survive. And of course, this, as long as this is the situation, it's very hard to set minimum standards, because then you would have to close down half of your hospitals. But then who will serve those regions and those people?
We are going to make the standard, and before implementation of the insurance, and it is the first of condition pre-implementation of the health insurance scheme. And being interesting, how much Hungarian citizen have to pay for insurance? So it is the some percent of the wages, or it is the contribution, insurance contribution, how much they have to pay, and it is the flat rate, or is the progressive, how it is?
It's a proportion of your salary up to a relatively high level, and then it doesn't, so beyond that, it doesn't add up. And if you are not employed, then you have to pay a flat rate of something like 25 euros a month.
And just a remark, so for individual entrepreneurs, there is a scheme, then they pay 50,000 for it, about 90,000 dirhams a month. So that includes income tax and social insurance for the pension fund and health insurance.
Yeah, I was oversimplifying. There is this special deal for small entrepreneurs, right? That the idea was to bring general tax burden and administrative burden down by making this a very simple, you know, one sum that you pay. And then it's included as I mentioned. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Some other questions from the audience?
Hi. First of all, let me
introduce myself, yes. My name is Avet Grigorian. I was Deputy Minister of Health in Armenia in 1919. And we start, first of all, thank you for your very helpful information about Hungarian healthcare reforms. I have very hard working in 1919s and when we started healthcare reforms in Armenia. the main lesson I take from your presentation is that the healthcare reforms is the main, the very big problem for any government in any country in the world and take the main place in the programs of any yes. I want to ask you about the few, in few words, please tell me a little bit detailed about the central decentralization of governmental, from the government of Hungary during this healthcare system, of the governing of the healthcare system from Ministry of Health, the decentralization of functions, which I hope take place during these healthcare reforms. This is my first question. Thank you.
So you're absolutely right saying that every country, this is a huge challenge for every country. And if you follow American politics, right? I mean, basically the one thing that Barack Obama got done was a healthcare reform and he was proud. Right, so this is because Bill Clinton couldn't get across the same thing. So it's this is true, and this is first order thing in every country in terms of policy. Now, in terms of decentralization, there are okay. So the health insurance was somewhat separate from health policy in Hungary. So the financing part was a separate administration from the ministry part. They are, you know, financing was under the ministry, but it was separate element. What I didn't stress at all was the provision of healthcare services, how that was organized. The general practitioners were by that time I'm speaking of almost all individual entrepreneurs. So it's the local governments that maintain the districts for general practitioners, and you could buy yourself into a district and were financed by the number of people who were your patients. And this works reasonably well in Hungary. So that was one part. For outpatient departments, those were affiliated usually with city or county self-governments or municipal governments. So they were provided also some private provision, but mostly it was local governments that were in that ran the outpatient departments. And as for hospitals at the time were also affiliated with county local governments and city local governments. So it was, again, there were some private and NGO and church affiliated hospitals, but mostly it was towns or cities who ran the hospitals and who appointed the head doctor and whatever, which of course explains to some extent why closing down a hospital was a huge political fight with respect to local government. Now, this was the situation at the time. It's not anymore. So Fidesz, the right-wing political party that came to power in 2010 on the back of the failure of this reform and other things, and who have been in power since, centralized a lot of decentralized systems. And one of them is hospitals and outpatient departments. So now those are managed by a nationwide body that reports to the ministry. So they are centralized. So to a large extent. Well, the individual hospitals, of course, still have a huge autonomy, but they don't report to the local government. They report to a central management agency that was working for a while, and now under the pandemic, they have been thrown under the Ministry of Interior, basically, because they thought that they are more efficient in dealing with the pandemic. So that's the short of it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. And the second question about the principles you take during these healthcare reforms, the principles of privatization of hospitals in Hungary, and what do you think about how they take their work in this pandemic situation?
Well,
pandemic situation.
Well, I
mean, governmental and private hospitals.
Well, there are relatively few private hospitals still in Hungary. There is a sizable sector of church-affiliated hospitals. This present government is very supportive of the mainstream churches, Christian churches, and they have taken over several hospitals and social institutions and other things like that. But COVID was an occasion for the government to further centralize. So basically they sent out military to hospitals, uniformed military. Well, for logistic reasons, but this government doesn't believe in decentralization. They did the same thing with respect to schools, basically. They took away schools from local government and centralized that as well. So at this point, we are in the business of centralization and certainly not privatization. Now, there is an opposite process with respect to higher education, but that takes us very far.
Okay, Mr. Walsh, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, Boris.
Hello.
I have one question. How important is the role of civil society in medical reforms process?
Very good question. The Armen mentioned that at the time there was a constant demonstration in front of the health ministry for months against the reform, the main thrust of the reforms. And that was not, some of it was supported to some extent by opposition political parties, right? Because it was an occasion to, fight the people in power, but to a large extent, it was organized by different NGOs who were active in this field. And since this was there were many, many narratives about the reform, but one was that this was a neoliberal market-based reform where they want to take away things from the government and take away our assurances that come from the government and throw it at some private insurance company. So there were left-wing-ish NGOs that were against it, but there was also the idea that these are the socialists, right, who are doing some crazy thing to take away money, basically, because they have been so profligate in the previous time, and you have to, stand up against them. So there was a variety of very different organizations. Clearly, the well-organized doctors and nurses, whatever, their own organizations were also entering the fray, usually against the reform. Actually, the very first salvo of the reform was that the government changed the rules of the doctors' membership in the doctor's chamber, right? The professional organization that all doctors belong to. And they changed it from obligatory to voluntary. So they decided that up until the summer of 2006, if you were a doctor, you couldn't practice without being a member of the Chamber of Doctors in Hungary. And the government said, no, you can practice without being a member of the chamber. You can leave the chamber if you don't like what they represent, and you can still be a doctor. So basically, they tried to counteract an expected resistance by the doctors by making it possible to maybe set up parallel chambers of doctors who are supporting the reform or something like that. Nothing like that really, you know, built up. So yes, different professional organizations, different politically motivated, but not organizations that were not political parties. Those were all participating in this. Local, when the hospital wanted, the government wanted to close down your small town's hospital, that was a battling cry for local, you know, local organizations that were, you know, just trying to maintain the importance of your small town. So yes, a lot of NGOs were present and they were very active in this story, almost all of them against the reform.
An additional question that I wanted to ask, it's about the recent years situation mostly. How about the shortage of doctors now? Because many who speak English or German move to other EU member countries because they don't need additional licensing. So how is the situation in Hungary in this regard?
That's an issue, and it's a well-documented issue, and it's getting worse year over year. There is a hope that this increase in salaries that I mentioned, this relatively high, you know, steep increase in salaries this last year, that this might stem the number of doctors who leave Hungary for Western Europe. But this is an issue. There is relatively little that you can do. I mean, as long as you are an EU member and there is a free movement of labor, and as long as those other countries accept, you know, Hungarian physicians training as adequate, I mean, there are limitations to what you can do. You can try and, you know, increase the number of medical students, but you know, also there was a study that suggests that it's not just leaving the country, it's also leaving the profession. So that many medical doctors end up working for a drug company or, you know, or ending up in some other white collar job. And presumably when you increase the salary, the reaction will be quicker from these people than from people who have already settled in Germany and who will not, you know, come back because the huge wage gap has been brought down a little bit by a Hungarian salary hike. But this is a big challenge. This is a big challenge. It's going on. I mean, another thing that has been suggested is that the dividing line between what doctors are expected to do and what nurses are expected to do can be changed somewhat, at least as far as administration is concerned, and taking, you know, the first questionnaire and, you know, giving a routine injection so that you can basically give more work to nurses. And that might also help a little bit, but nobody has a cure all for this. It's a big challenge.
Thank you. So, any other questions maybe from the audience? We have a few more minutes. Okay, then. Well, but my question, so I'm not a healthcare specialist, so my question is about again about the current situation. So the issue of overbuying these lung ventilators, it's mm-hmm. been in Hungarian media for months now, and the government has been trying to sell some of them, but not so successful, I guess.
Well, that's true. If it wasn't so sad, it would be rather funny. At the time in the springtime when it it was not just Hungary, it was several countries where it looked that the bottleneck would be ventilators and that people will get into hospital and they will have to die because there are not enough ventilators. Then Orban, the government was not very coordinated. It was very enthusiastic and very, you know, generous, but not very well coordinated in terms of trying to increase the number of ventilators. So basically they sent out a number of people to different markets to try and buy more ventilators, and they did, but nobody coordinated this, and nobody, it was cost was cost. It was like, no matter how much it costs, we shall buy them. And they were successful at a very high cost. So Hungary paid a lot of for these ventilators. The one of the minor mess ups was when the containers arrived and there was Chinese inscription on the containers, and those who could read Chinese suggested that it meant not for medical use, right? So presumably ventilators were imported that were not for medical use. And Hungary spent a lot of money and got a lot of ventilators, and thank goodness Hungary managed quite well the first wave, the spring wave of the disease. So Hungary didn't need even close to as many ventilators that it bought at high cost. And ever since, you know, Hungary has been trying to flog that. we have not succeeded. Others probably overbought too, because we have not succeeded yet. I mean, it's quite a Hungarian story. There is a certain amount of voluntarism in the government behavior, right? They think that they can solve things by will and money, right? Instead of more traditional coordinated administrative methods, and this was the outcome. Well, of course, it's the benefit of hindsight, right? I mean, if things have worked out in a different way and Hungary had needed a lot of ventilators, then nobody would have blamed the government for having spent so much money on those ventilators. So it's relatively easy to be critical after a big challenge that everyone was, you know, facing the fog of war and nobody quite knew, you know, what was coming up next.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. If